All across our state, God is moving, transforming, touching lives in miraculous ways. He is moving in our homes, neighborhoods, our communities. As we stand united in a singular church body committed to reaching the lost, He is making lives new through the hands and feet of His followers. And as God moves through the generosity of our Oklahoma Baptist churches, we see Christ's love impacting not just our state, but all around the world. No matter who you are, God calls you to be a part of His church. He invites us all to know Him, to step into our unique calling, to find a place to serve in His kingdom. Through every member and every congregation this year, we've seen His Spirit move and work in astounding ways, feeding the hungry, creating belonging for all, and igniting His love in the hearts of His followers.
God is going to do the work of His kingdom through the local church. It really feeds into this whole idea that we have the Southern Baptist in cooperation. Is when we give either to the cooperative program or we give to mission offerings, it enables us as individuals, as churches, to be a part of something much bigger than ourselves.
Through faithfulness, through giving, God has allowed Oklahoma Baptists to be the hands and feet of Jesus in impactful ways all around the globe. Join us once again in giving to the state mission offering and sharing the love of Christ to those that need it most.
Well, this is the Eddie McMillan State Missions Offering Month throughout the month of September. And over the next 5 weeks, we will be seeing some videos and reminding us. And you should have received in your bulletin a little prayer guide and telling you about a little bit of where the money's going and what to pray about. And then also, there are envelopes around. And I hope that you will give. We as a church have voted to set a goal of $2,400, and so please give. This is 100% going to state missions. Okay, this is not a church offering. This is a state missions offering that we're participating in, that we support, and various types of works around the state. And you'll again notice some of them, not all of them, but some of them are listed here in this. And I hope that you will give this month and give generously. Okay, and be praying for these things. We are always glad to have folks with us. I see some folks back, and we have especially one young man who used to come as a youth back in the 90s, Jason Pendergrass. Some of you will remember him back in the day, and we're glad to have him back here with us, and just glad that each of you are here. And if I'm missing somebody, point them out. Okay, we're always, I hope you've invited people this week. That was a goal, is to invite and encourage and bring somebody if you could. And we had a good numbers in Sunday school, and that's the key. All right? How about birthdays? Anybody have a birthday this week?
All right.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Glad to have you back. You weren't supposed to be back. He's supposed to be on vacation. He told me he's going to be gone 2 weeks, but he's back in the second week.
All right. Okay, everybody, please be seated. And Brother Larry, I need to remind you that the 90s are not back in the day.
I agree.
But okay. All right, the 90s are not back in the day. That just seems like... Okay.
It's 30 years.
I know. Okay. All right, everybody. Good morning. How are you? Good. Good. Want to thank Scott for stepping in, doing the music last week. Thank you, Scott. Appreciate it, Scott. All right. And we're going to praise the Lord this morning with hymn number 159. There's power in the blood this morning.
Would you be free?
from the burden of sin. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would grease tide? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be wider, much wider than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praise and sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Okay, we're going to sing a little chorus called More Precious Than Silver right now, okay? And we're going to do it a cappella, all right? I'm doing this so Lori could look this up back there. I'm stalling for a second. All right. Lord, you are more precious than silver. Lord, you are more costly than gold. Lord, you are more beautiful than diamonds, and nothing I desire compares with you. Now I want you to think a little bit as we worship this morning for the rest of the service. How do you feel about the Lord in your heart and in your life? Is he valuable to us? Is he important to us? And maybe we need to commit to this in our life, you know, that the Lord is more valuable than anything else to us. So let's sing it one more time through, okay? Lord, you are more precious than silver. Lord, you are more costly than gold. Lord, you are more beautiful than diamonds, and nothing I desire compares with you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, everybody. Almighty God, we come to you this morning and we bow before you and we praise your holy name, Father, for you are the possessor of heaven and earth, Lord God, and we worship before you. And Father, I pray that you forgive us for our arrogance and our pride, Lord God, that we would even dare to compare things to you, Lord. I pray that your name would be lifted up. Father, you are the great I am, and you have made us. We have not made you. And Father, I pray that you help each one of us to draw near to you this morning, that you help us all to see the importance of this hour this morning, Lord God, that we hear your word and that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from your mouth. And I just ask today that you help us to concentrate on you, that you help us to worship in spirit and truth, that you help us to be serious this morning, and Father, to have reverence for you. And Lord, we thank you so much for who you are, for your love, for your integrity, for your generosity, Almighty God, for your kindness and giving us second and third and fourth and 100 chances, Lord God. Father, that you are long-suffering. We are in awe of you this morning. And I pray that you help us all to worship and concentrate on you today. And these words are in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, did anyone have something this morning you'd like to praise the Lord for? Yes. All right, for your class this morning, praise the Lord. Come on, everybody. Praise the Lord. Okay. All right, anybody else have a praise the Lord this morning? All right. Praise the Lord. Okay. Anybody else have a praise the Lord? I praise the Lord for vacation. Praise the Lord. Yes. Okay. Uh-huh. Praise the Lord. Man, I got 2 inches of my rain gauge. I came home and...
Build up a pool.
Yeah, I know. Okay. I know what you mean. Okay. Praise the Lord for the rain. It's great. All right, yes.
I'd like to praise the Lord for Christian friends at church that help you take care of your house.
Okay, all right. Praise the Lord for Christian friends that help. Okay? All right, Amelia?
I praise the Lord that you're back.
Oh, really? Okay, well.
We like Scott.
Yeah. Well, I praise the Lord for my granddaughter, too, okay? Praise the Lord, everybody. Okay, anybody else have praise the Lord? Okay, all right. And just remember, the 90s are not back in the day. Okay, we're going to sing Standing on the Promises 335, and after the first verse, we will say hello to one another, okay? Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Lord, in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Thank you.
Promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Oh, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Okay, if you would return to your seats. Please be seated, everybody. We're going to sing Wonderful Cross. Maybe I've got the coughs. I'll find my way.
Thank you.
Number 277, We Have Heard the Joyful Sound. And this is going to be our offertory. So on the fourth verse, would you guys please stand?
Heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land, climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward 'tis our Lord's command, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wafted on the rolling tide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing ye islands of the sea, echo back ye ocean caves. Earth shall keep her jubilee, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing above the battle strife, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. By his death and endless life, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing it softly through the gloom, when the heart for mercy craves, sing in triumph o'er the tomb, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Give the winds a mighty voice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free, highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory, Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Let's pray.
Father, what a glory and wonderful day it is to be in your house today. And we thank you so much that Jesus does save, Father. We thank you for that. Thank you for your word we're going to hear today, Lord. Thank you for the worship time and the singing, Lord. We're just so blessed by it. And Lord, we ask you to bless the gift and the giver, and we accept these tithes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Turn your Bibles, book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 7. John chapter 7, we'll begin reading at verse 37. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful to be here today. Thank you for each one that's come. We thank you for your Spirit who indwells your people. Thank you for your word, for your promises, for your faithfulness. For your word is faithful and true because you are faithful and true. Holy is the name of the Lord Jesus, and we pray in his name for your will to be done. In Christ's name, amen.
Yeah.
Richard, thank you for leading us. Thanks for being back. All right? All right. But you were supposed to have vacation. You're supposed to take some time off, but we're glad to have you back. If you'll turn your Bibles to the book of John, the Gospel of John, and I hope you will turn. If you don't have a Bible, find you one. There are some in the pew racks. If you have your electronic device, I don't like them, but you can use them. I can't hear the pages rattle or shuffle or anything like that. But if you've got your Bible, you need it open because that's where the blessing is. And keep it open during the service because God's word will speak to you. All right? So let's turn and we're in John chapter 7, start verse 37. And let's read once again. And it tells us there, on the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Now, obviously, we need to understand the background of this passage of Scripture. Now, the Jews had many, many ceremonies and festivals and feasts and so forth. And one of them that stood out among them all, that was with more joy, more fanfare, more hilarity, if you will, and festivity, is the Feast of the Tabernacles. In particular, the last day, what they call the Sukkot, S-U-K-K-O-T. At the feast, the Jews would gather together and they would perform this. The high priest on that last day would go down to the pool of Siloam, and he would dip a pitcher out in that pool, bringing up water. People are surrounding him. They're laughing, they're joying, they're singing, they're praising, they're quoting scripture, they're dancing, they're just having a great time. And they would go all the way back up to the Temple Mount. And here the priest would then pour that water of Siloam out of the pitcher onto the altar. And people just bust out in laughter and joy. This is one of the most fun festive occasions in the Jewish yearly calendar that they would enjoy themselves. And they were doing this. Now Jesus is walking along. He's watching all this. He's there seeing all their ecstasy and joy and dancing and fun and so forth. And the last day in the midst of this, now... Jesus is not normally a show-off, flamboyant type of person. The Bible tells us in Matthew 12:19, speaking of Jesus, "He will not quarrel, nor cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets." Yet at this time, Jesus could not hold it in any longer. And the Bible tells us in verse 37, he stood up and he cried out, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink." Now, what's up with this? What is this about here? Jesus sees this ceremony. He sees what they're doing here, all the chanting, all the singing, all the shouting, all the laughing, the dancing, and so forth. In Isaiah chapter 13, verse 3, it says, "Therefore, with joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation." Jesus Christ himself is that well of salvation. See, every Old Testament ceremony, every Old Testament ritual, festival, feast, etc., are all prophecy, portraying a picture of Jesus. And so right there, Jesus is that living water right there in their midst. Now, the people aren't paying attention to him. They don't understand what he's talking about. They are going about their religion. They're going about their festival. They are enjoying and going through their ritual and their shouting and their singing and their feast and so forth. But right there in their midst is the living water. Right there among them. Now what Jesus knew was that when this was all over, when all the singing and shouting and laughing and dancing and so forth, that would be over and they would go back home. And it would just be a memory. When the last laughter, when the last dancing, when the last song was sung, everybody would go back to their own way of life, back to whatever they did in life, all back to the regular toils and tragedies and heartaches and tears and pains and disappointments and addictions and so forth. And all this joy and laughter would be over. It was just a religious ritual. It was a religious ceremony here. It was a religious exercise. And it was over and would just be a memory. Nothing more, nothing less. Now, Jesus sees this pitcher of water poured out, and he sees all this, and Jesus shouts out, "If you're really thirsty, come to me and drink." Now, we look here, and Jesus is saying, it's time to stop enduring. It's time to stop suffering through the old, stale, stagnant water of religion and start enjoying your salvation. Start enjoying something that is real, not the symbolism of religion that you have. Now understand, most people in America have plenty of religion. We got more than enough religion in the world. What people need in our country, what people need around the world is a vibrant personal relationship with Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and enjoy your salvation, to rejoice in that salvation. And so Jesus is saying, come to me and drink. Will you draw from the water of the well of life? Will you draw and bring in Christ? Jesus says, come to me. What a great lesson this is. What a great important truth we need to grasp here. There's not another liquid on this planet that can satisfy like the water of life. People are drinking their life away with the junk of this world. People are sneaking off to sip of that which pickles the liver. People are drinking of those things that causes addiction and enslavement. And yet it is Christ our Lord that gives us true faith, true freedom, true rejoicing, true satisfaction. Only in Christ can we find that freedom, that rest. Remember, Jesus says, come to me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now, again, Jesus is talking about salvation and more. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. That when you get saved, the Holy Spirit will come in your life. And they will flow out of your life. He will flood, come springing up. And you will have a river of revival, a river of life flowing out of you. He says, for he who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Now, is that your experience? Do you have that river bubbling up out of your soul, out of your life? Is there satisfaction deep down in your heart because you have drunk deeply of the Lord Jesus Christ? But see, more than satisfaction, are you blessing others? Because not only are you going to drink of this water that satisfies you, it's going to flow through you to bless others. Now, I'm amazed at times at what people are doing, looking for meaning and purpose, contentment in their life. Some are trying to find in academia, in knowledge, you know, in intellect. They want all the various degrees, and they go to this school and that seminary and that conference and this, and they'll study this subject. They want to learn more facts about this and this theology and this mathematics and this philosophy and all these things. They fill up their head, but their heart's still empty. Is that where the answer's at, in the intellect? Others want to do anything and everything. Just be active. Go for the thrills. Go to sightseeing or work. They find their meaning and purpose in work and their career and so forth. Some find it in working for the church. I mean, after all, a happy Christian is a working Christian. And work, 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 work. And toil your fingers to the bone and even to the demise of their own, you know, domestic tranquility. And they work and work, and yet they still can't find it in here. Others want to find that peace in emotionalism. You know, crank up the music, sing some songs, or hear some sad stories. You know, some people think if you're not enjoying, if you're not singing and dancing and having a good time, if you're not feeling it, we're doing something wrong. Is that where it's at? I mean, these people there that Jesus is watching there in that day of that feast, they're having a good time. It's a very emotional event, but it's going to end, and it'll just be a memory. We can come and we can have very emotional times. I remember, you know, in the past, be at church and just my heart's broken and tears going down my cheek, and I go home and say, man, I was really close to God. God really spoke to me today. And then next week I'm looking for it again, and I didn't get it again. Was I less close to God? Was I further away from God? No. I was looking for emotions. Emotions isn't a sign truly that you're close to God. It's nice if you have it, but it isn't proof that you're walking with God or not. Listen, when you're always looking for emotions, you're always looking for the next one. You know, it's like a drug addict. Once you have that high, you say, well, I got to have that again, and you're taking more drugs. You're going increasing, and you'll never be satisfied. And so it's not the emotion. So is it intellectual? Is it activity? Is it emotion? Or some would say it's to live the life like a Pharisee. You know, this very austere religious life and the things you don't do. You know, I don't smoke, I don't drink, I don't cuss, I don't dip, and I don't go with the girls who do. You know, this is the type of the Pharisees. And they say, you got to have this kind of life. But is that it? This Pharisees had the religion, but they didn't know Jesus. They didn't know the real what he was talking about here. And so you all these things are distractions from the reality of life. It's just old, dead water of religion. When Jesus stood up on that last day and cried out, he says, if you're thirsty, are you thirsty? Come to me, drink of me, and you'll have rivers of living water flowing out of your most deepest being. So what I want you to see today is how you can have that, how you need that. And I want you to comprehend some things. And four in particular. First thing you need to comprehend are the subjects. The subject, what I'm talking about, is who is Jesus speaking to? Who is he referring to? Well, he's not referring to everybody. Now, we know that Jesus calls everybody, but he's really not speaking to everybody here. He's speaking to those who are thirsty. Because there's a big word there that says, if. If you are thirsty, if any man is thirsty. So that brings a question. Are you thirsty? Are you thirsty? Now, many will say, well, God knows I'm empty. Well, I'm not asking if you're empty. I'm asking if you're thirsty. My truck's been empty many times, but it's never been thirsty. And there's a lot of people that are empty, but they're not thirsty. There's a lot of people that are not satisfied. You know, or they are satisfied, but they're not thirsty. They're not looking for anything. They come to church as if they're doing God a great big glorious favor to be here, and they're not seeking God. If you're thirsty, you're going to be seeking God. Now, some have a shallow thirst, and they'll have a shallow satisfaction. But most are not thirsty because they're filled up with the junk of the world. They're filled up with the, you know, self-love and religion and feel-good stuff and all this other stuff, but they're not thirsty for reality. For the eternal realities here. And so you need to know that Christ is the way to satisfy. Now, I don't know how much God you have. But I'll tell you this. You got all the God you want. Now, the thing is, it is not our job to persuade God to fill us up. Because he already wants us full. Jesus said in Matthew 5:6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Now, if you don't have any more, it's because you don't want any more. You have as much as you want. Do you have that desire? Do you have that thirst here? The reason you don't have more is not because God's neglected you or ignored you, but you've neglected or ignored God. How much of God do you want? You have to thirst for him here. And so, are you thirsty? Now, if you're not thirsty, let me suggest something here. That you analyze your life. You just pray, God, show me the order I should be in. Show me the big picture here. Give me a burning, blistering thirst for you. So the subject are, who are those that are thirsty? Are you one of them? Second thing you need to comprehend is the source. Jesus says, if you thirst, come to me. He's talking about himself. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now understand, you don't come to religion, you don't come to ritualism, you don't come to rationalization, you don't come to resolve or any of those things. You don't even clean up your life and say, now Lord, maybe I qualify for your blessings. Now, this is where we make a big mistake. We think somehow that we have to do some things to get God, get ourselves ready for God to pour out his blessing, to pour out his spirit upon us. If we want more God, we want more spirit of God and so forth, we think that, hey, I have to clean up my life. I have to get serious about Bible study, coming to church, praying more, reading more, etc. And then maybe I'll qualify for God to pour out his spirit and fill me up with his life. Now, all those things are works of righteousness, and they don't work. They're not going to make it work in your life. It's like a man who's struggling in quicksand. The more he struggles, the deeper he sinks. Now, here's the lesson of lessons that we all need to learn. Everybody needs to get this down. In your heart, your mind, on paper, whatever. And it's this. Holiness is not the way to Christ. Christ is the way to holiness. Holiness is not the way to Christ. You don't work your way to the way. He is the way. It is Jesus who makes you holy. It is not us making ourselves holy to be like Jesus here. You can't live right. If we could live right, then that's the thing. We think, if I can clean up my life, I can get my life in order, then God will make me holy. He'll pour His Spirit out on me. But that doesn't work that way. If you could do all those things, then why do you need to be filled? That's like, you know how to get a loan from a banker? Go to the banker and prove that you got money, you don't need it, and he'll give you a loan. Now, that's not how God is. God works on grace. Come to Jesus. Don't come when you're stronger. Don't come when you're cleaner. Don't come when you got things in order. Come as you are. Come in your weakness. Come in your fears. Come in your tears. Come as you are. Bring it all to Jesus. He has his arms wide open, ready and willing for you to come. Now, that doesn't mean that you come clinging to your sins. That doesn't mean you cross your fingers and hold it back behind your back as if you got another option. And that doesn't mean you come with the world as your dearest friend. It means come as you are and say, Lord, I don't want any of this. I want you. And he will clean you up. He will make you righteous. He will cleanse you and fill you with his Spirit. So the subject are who's thirsty, and the source is Jesus. Third, we must comprehend a secret here. Excuse me. Verse 37. On the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Now, what does that mean? How do you drink? You drink by faith. The very next verse, verse 38, explains it. It says, he who believes in me, you drink Christ in. You drink by faith. You appropriate, you assimilate, you draw him in to your life. Now, the problem is many people will be with me all the way up to this point, 100%. Yes, I'm thirsty. Yes, Jesus is the answer. And they drop it. It never gets there. They just stop all of a sudden. It may be written now in the margin of your Bible. It may be written in your notes. It may be written up here, but it never gets to the soul. Somewhere, the person has to drink. Somewhere in here, it has to be more than just knowledge here. You know, you have to drink. You have to appropriate. You have to assimilate. You have to bring Christ in. Drinking is not passive. It is active. There have been children, teenagers, adults that's come to church year after year after year, got all the answers in the Bible. They can tell you where every book is. They can tell you what the chapter is about. They can tell you all the answers and quizzes and trivia, but they've never taken a drink of Jesus. They never trusted Christ to be their Lord and Savior. There comes a time when a person says, Jesus, I have to have you. I'm tired of all this other stuff. I'm tired of the religion. I need you. And by faith, I'm taking you. I'm drinking you in. I'm believing you. Suppose you're in the desert. You've been there for a long time, several days, and you are dehydrated. Your body's hurting. Your head's hurting. You're seeing spots. Your lips are parched. They're cracked. They're bleeding. You're thirsty, and you know it. Nobody has to explain to you what's going on in your body. Nobody has to tell you you're dehydrated. Nobody has to tell you what water is and what you need and so forth. But then suddenly, out of the blue, miraculously, somebody shows up with a big old glass of water. And it's big, it's clear, and it's full. And it's got ice cubes in it. And it's sweating on the outside. And by the way, how much would you give? Would you give a dollar for that glass? Would you give $2? How about $5? How about $10? How about $50? Or $100? Or $10,000? See, when you're thirsty, when your life is in line, price is not a matter. It doesn't matter. You know you'll give anything for your life. And so many people come to argue and debate and have these issues about God and Jesus and the Bible. They're not thirsty. When you're thirsty, the price doesn't matter. The cost, it is a thing here. And so the mark of a thirsty person is that I need Jesus no matter what. I have to have Christ. I need to drink. Now, it's a paradox in a way. This drink is absolutely free. It's been paid for. But you can't have anything else. You can't have Pepsi along with it. You can't have the things of the world. It's got to be Jesus and only Jesus. And so it costs you. You got to turn loose of everything else. Now, suppose here that this person brings you your water and says, here, I want you to have it. But you pull out your notebook and you start writing notes. Okay, that glass is about 7 inches tall. It's about 2.5 inches diameter. It's got so much volume. It's about 33 degrees. It's cold. It's clear. And you're just taking notes. And the guy says, here, you can drink it. It's yours. But you just keep drinking, you know, taking notes down. You know, it looks clear. I think it's a great water, but do I really qualify and so forth? Now, people is observing this. Says, what's wrong with them? Why don't they claim this promise, this offer for them to have here? You realize there are people who come to church Sunday after Sunday with absolutely no intention of doing what the pastor asked of them any more than doing what the commercials wanted them to do last night on TV. We come, we watch, we observe, and we go home without Christ. There has to come a time when a person drinks of Jesus. D-R-I-N-K. Where you bring him in, you draw him in, you assimilate him, you take him into your life. You say, my heart is dry, my heart is empty, I need Jesus. Jesus, you and only you, please, I want you, I have to have you. Right now by faith, I believe. Are you one of the subjects? Are you thirsty? Remember, the source is Jesus. He's the answer. But the secret is you have to drink of him. And that brings us to the fourth point, to comprehend the supply. And this will be a blessing, I believe. This thing I think you'll love. Verse 38 again says, he who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Now, not only is there an income, but there's an outflow here. There's bringing up from you wells and rivers of blessing, a revival of blessing. Now, here's a problem or a curiosity. Jesus says, as the scripture has said. So Jesus is referring to scripture. Now, does everybody have a concordance at home? What's a concordance? All right, let me stop here and chase a rabbit. This, do a little pastoral administrative stuff. Every Christian here, in your home, in your life, need three other books in your library, besides your daily Bible that you read out, that's your personal Bible. Everybody, you need to access at least these three books. One is a good study Bible. All right? Now, if you don't have a study Bible, you need one. Somewhere in your house, in your home, you need a good quality study Bible. And if you don't have one, if you like to have a reference or something, come talk to me. I'll show you a couple, and there's more Mardell's, and you can find them. All right? They're online. If you don't use an actual physical book, they're online. You can get a study Bible there. But a study Bible will have notes and references and maps and geography and history notes and all kinds of stuff, extra information. Everybody needs a concordance. Now, what is a concordance? A concordance is a book that lists every single word in the Bible in alphabetical order. The purpose of a concordance is you're trying to think of a verse. Oh, I'm trying to, all right, where's this verse at? But you can't remember. But you can remember a key word or two. Let's say John 3:16. You know, whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You remember that word believe. Now, also, when you say concordance, you need the type of concordance that goes along with the Bible you read. If you read a King James, you need a King James concordance. If you read a Revised Standard Version, you need a Revised Standard Version concordance or an NIV, therefore NIV concordance, because you get the words matching. So you're looking for the word believe. And so you go to the B's and go to alphabetical order, and they're going to have a little snippet of each verse that word is found. Because every place that word is found in the Bible, it's going to be listed there in a little context. And you go down and say, oh, there it is, whosoever believe. All right? And you say, John 3:16. So now you can turn to John 3:16 and find it. So a concordance. The other is a dictionary. Now the Strong's Exhaustive Concordance has a dictionary in the back. Some of your Bibles will have a partial concordance and partial dictionary in your Bible, but that's not enough. You need the full thing. You need a good Bible dictionary that gives you the definitions of Bible words. All right? Now, back to my point. if you were to look in your concordance for this verse that Jesus is referring to, you would not find it. Isn't that interesting here? Jesus says, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. He's referring to the Old Testament. You will not find that verse anywhere in the Old Testament. Now, does that mean Jesus is wrong? No, Jesus is never wrong. Jesus is not quoting a literal verse here. He's referring to a teaching. He's referring to the sum total of some verses, if you will. All right? There's a number of verses here that he's referring to, and they're in particular Ezekiel chapter 47. So turn your Bibles to Ezekiel 47. Before we get there, I need you to understand some things. Jesus is saying when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, when you get saved, the Holy Spirit's going to come in and fill you up. You're going to be filled, and therefore you're going to be overflowing with joy. You're going to be overflowing with praise. You're going to be overflowing with testimony. You're going to be overflowing with service. All right? Now, before we get to Ezekiel 47, I need to ask you a question. Are you a normal Christian? I'm not asking if you're an average Christian, because an average Christian is just one that comes to church, you know, on Sundays and are subnormal. But a normal, we're talking about a biblical Christian. What is a normal Christian? Well, a normal biblical Christian is one who's tired of enduring religion and is enjoying their salvation. A normal Christian is somebody who not only has their own needs met through Christ, but is meeting the needs of others because the river is flowing through them. See, sometimes, a lot of times, people come to church, boy, I want a blessing today. Lord, I just need you to meet my need. Lord, if you just satisfy a little bit of my thirst, that's the normal or average Christian. But do you come and say, Lord, make me a blessing to somebody today? Lord, flow through me. Flow your river through me to somebody else. There is a biblical, normal Christian. Now, let's learn the secret to what this is all about here. In chapter 47, it's a prophecy. Is a vision that God gives Ezekiel here. And I believe this is what Jesus is talking about. Ezekiel 47:1. Then he brought me back to the door of the temple. Now obviously that's the temple of God here. The Old Testament temples and tabernacles and tent meetings and so forth are always pictures of you and I as believers. Because in 1 Corinthians 3:16 it tells us that you or I, we are the temple of God. See, in the Old Testament, God had a temple for his people. In the New Testament, he has a temple or a people for his temple here. And so these Old Testament temples and feasts and tabernacles are all portraying something of the future. They're all painting a picture, a prophecy of things to come. Now, Ezekiel 47:1 again. Then he brought me back to the door of the temple, and there was water flowing from under the threshold of the temple toward the east, for the front of the temple faced east. The water was flowing from under the right side of the temple, south of the altar. Now, here's what I want to show you about this river here. And I'll try to be as brief as possible, as quickly as possible, we move along. The five things I want you to see. First of all, the source. It's coming out of the temple here, which is you and I. The mystery here is it's going right past the altar. Now, the altar speaks of the crucifixion of Christ. Because Jesus died on God's altar. Jesus, the Lamb of God, died on God's altar, the cross. And the only way to have the river of life flowing out of your life is you go through the cross. You will always come by the altar of God, through Christ. All right? You will not have this flowing river out of your life without the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ, without Him. All right? That's the first thing about this source. Secondly is the course. Now, let's read verse 2 to 5. He brought me out by the way of the north gate and led me around on the outside of the outer gateway that faces east, and these was waters running out of the right side. And when the man went out to the east with the line in his hand, he measured 1,000 cubits and brought me through the waters. The waters came to my ankles. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters, and the water was up to my knees. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters, and it came up to my waist. Again he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not cross, For the water was too deep, water in which one must swim, or a river that could not be crossed. Now here's this mysterious river, and it keeps getting deeper and wider, deeper and wider, deeper and wider. There's no tributaries, but it keeps getting bigger. Now this is the course of the river. Every 500 yard increments, that's, you know, 1,000 cubits, so if it's an 18 inch cubit, all right? And it's going from ankle deep to knee deep to waist deep and so forth. And the writer says there in verse 6, "Son of man, have you seen these things?" Here's a river of revival, a river of life that's flowing out of you. At first it's ankle deep, then it's going to get knee deep, and it's going to get waist deep, and it becomes just a torrent of river. Now some of you, you got it at your ankle right now. Are you satisfied? I pray that you want it deeper. Some of you may have it at your knee. Are you satisfied? I pray, God, that you want it deeper. Some of you, the river of life is still only up to your waist. Are you satisfied? I pray you want it deeper. And some are there in a torrent that's sweeping across, and you enjoy, but the sweeping, you're swimming, it is all there. And so this is the marked course. It's going to get bigger and deeper and wider and so forth in your life. Third thing I want you to notice is the mighty force of this river. And again, I wish I had more time. I want you to see what happens when this river flows. Verse 7 to 9. "When I returned there, along the bank of the river were very many trees, and on one side and the other. Then he said to me, 'This water flows toward the eastern region, goes down into the valley, and enters the sea. When it reaches the sea, waters are healed. And it shall be that every living thing that moves, wherever that river goes, will live. There will be a very great multitude of fish, because these waters go there, for they will be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes.'" Now, if you and I could go to Israel today, and there's really two illustrations I want you to see there. One is an illustration of a lost person, a person who dies and will end up in death and hell. And this is pictured in the image of the Jordan River. It starts up in the conception of life in the mountains of Syria, comes down to the Sea of Galilee, down to the Jordan Valley, ends up at the Dead Sea. Death. Nothing left. Useless. Waste. But the real picture, the real image I want you to see is that image of a saved person. A person who knows Jesus. A person who is saved. That's what I want. And it all starts at the Temple Mount at the altar there. Now, if we could go to the Temple Mount today, there in Jerusalem, that's Mount Moriah. This is the same place where Abraham took Isaac. Now, that you're starting off there in the Temple Mount at 2,700 feet above sea level. You're looking to the east toward the desert, all right? And the terrain all of a sudden begins to go down, down. It drops and drops and it goes down and eventually ends up at the lowest place on the surface of this earth, 1,300 feet below sea level, the Dead Sea. Now, understand, there is no literal river flowing out of Jerusalem. There is no water, literal water, coming out of the Temple Mount. This is all symbolic. This is all, you know, spiritual, what we're talking about here. Now, here's what I believe Jesus is talking about here. Ezekiel saw a river coming out of the temple past the altar here. It's going down and down and down to the Dead Sea. But here's where Jesus comes in. Because he says in our text in John 7:38, "He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." He's saying there will be life. Living water. Where there's death, there'll be life. It'll be where once it was dying or dead, it will be living now. And it begins to flow out. Now look at verse 10 of Ezekiel 47. Ezekiel 47, 10. "It shall be that fishermen will stand by it from Engedi to Eglaim. They will be places for spreading their nets. Their fish will be of the same kinds as the fish of the great sea, exceedingly many." Suddenly, that water that is teeming with life is going to reach the Dead Sea. What was dead is now living. And it's going to be filled with life. And there'll be fish. There'll be more fish and a variety of fish as the Mediterranean Sea now. What once was dead is now alive. That's the symbology here. It's taken life-giving water all the way to that which is death or hell or condemnation in a person here. And so there's going to be many, many fish. Where there's failure, there's success. Where there's death, there's living. What was dead is now living. Now, how many of you wanted to be a fisherman of men? But the thing is, we're fishing in the Dead Sea. But the problem isn't the Dead Sea. We're not pouring out the living waters into it. Now, the fourth thing I want you to see here is the fruitfulness of this river. Where there was barrenness, there's fruitfulness. Verse 12, along the bank of the river, on this side and that, will grow all kinds of trees used for food. Their leaves will not wither, and their fruit will not fail. They will bear fruit every month because their water flows from the sanctuary. Now, I want to ask you, is your life fruitful or is it barren? Galatians tells us in Galatians 5:22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Is there a river flowing out of your life that's producing fruits of righteousness, fruits of the Holy Spirit, fruitfulness in your life that people can enjoy, they can see, they can taste of, they can be blessed with? But lastly, there is health where there was once sickness. The last part of verse 12 says, their fruit will be for food and their leaves for medicine. Folks, our world is sick. Sin sick. Dying. And it's going all the way to the Dead Sea with no hope. In your life, our world needs that fruit for health. Our world needs the medicine that the river of life gives here. Where there was death, there's life. Where there is sickness, there is health here. And so there at the Dead Sea, Jesus said, if you'll come to me, if you'll drink of me, a river of life will flow out of your life. And what was dead will be made alive. Where there is failure, there will be success. Where there is sickness, there will be health. Son of man, do you see? Do you see this? There is a distinct difference between the old, stale, stagnant waters of religion and the living water of Christ. Which do you have? Are you trusting in Jesus or some religion? Baptism doesn't save you. Catholicism doesn't save you. Going through the good works and being a good person doesn't save you. Those are religious things that end up in death. Only Christ is your life. Only through Him can you get the river of life flowing. His bowed eyes closed. Have you ever thirst so much? You said, Jesus, you're my only answer. You're who I need. I have to have you. Jesus, please be my Lord, my Savior. Flow through me. Father, I ask you to speak to each person here, man, woman, boy, girl. Reveal the truth of their hearts. The emptiness is there. The thirst is there. Or can be there. Father, I pray you'll make them thirsty. Prick their hearts. Show them the truth. Help them understand that Jesus is the only answer, the only remedy to their dry soul. Father, bless, speak, and fill. Help us as Christians to have the water running deeper in our lives, to flow out of us till it becomes a great torrent, a great river that's impassable any other way. Father, I pray that you just bless today, speak through your word, speak by your spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
156.
Saturday, 10 o'clock, WMU, over in the Family Life Building at 10 o'clock that morning. And then next Sunday's Word Dismissing will be our monthly business meeting. Anything else? Where is Jenny? There you are. I knew you guys were around here somewhere.
September the 17th, if you are a college student or if you are a quote-unquote young adult, we will be having a Taco Tuesday Nacho Normal game night at our house, here in Iowa House, from 5 to 8. You don't have to bring anything but yourself. So if you know anybody who's college age or anything like that, we'd love to have you at our home.
Basically, high school level, all right, and still feel young.
Yes.
Okay? That leaves me out. Okay, any other announcements? Anything else? All right, let's pray. Father, we are so grateful for the good spirit. Thank you for each one that's come this way. I pray that your word, your spirit, would truly bless the heart. That you would speak to us, that you will draw us, and that, that as we go from here, there's still somebody that needs the church, needs that church. They're first satisfied through Christ. Father, speak to them. Convict them. Draw them to Jesus. Father, we pray for their salvation. We ask for your will be done in each of our lives. Go with us this day. Watch over to take. And we just praise you. We love you. We thank you for all that you've done, for all that you're doing, and all that you will continue to do for your people, for this world. Jesus' name.
Amen. M6.